2 to the power 4 equals 4 to the power 2. Are there any other numbers that have the same property? So, that was the game I played last night after dinner, and I'm not really good with numbers, so I thought that the computer might help me get some insights into the question, into the game. So, I decided to throw the x to the y equals y to the x equation to the GPU in the computer, get a graph back, and this is what I got. So, you can see that there are many solutions to the problem. So, just to make it clear, this is the plane of x and y values. X is horizontal, y is vertical. This grid pattern expresses the integer numbers in the plane. And we do see that the graph does pass through the point 2, 4 and 4, 2, which were the original numbers that invited me to play the game. And there are many other solutions, although none of them seem to be integers. There is, of course, the diagonal line of trivial solutions, the x equals y. So, of course, 3 to the power 3 is 3 to the power 3, no mystery. So, these are boring solutions. But I wanted to have a look to the actual curve. And it seems to tend to 1 as x tends to infinity. And it also seems to explode to infinity as x tends to 1. Of course, the curve is symmetric because if you swap x and y, you get the same problem. You are asking the same problem. But I really wanted to have a look to that behavior of tending to 1. And it's very easy to prove it. If you express the game as the logarithm of x divided by x equals the logarithm of y divided by y, and it seems that you are making the problem more complex by throwing logarithms to it, but at least we are putting all the x's of the problem in one side of the equation and all the y's of the problem in the other side of the equation. That helps. So if we call the logarithm of something divided by something, if we call that g, then we can say that g of x equals g of y, and that's our problem. And we can plot g to have a look to it. It has this shape. It grows from x equals 1 to something, and then it starts dropping and going to 0 again. It's easy to find where that maximum point happens. If you take the derivatives of g equals 0 and you solve it, you get that point happens at e. So now the problem becomes finding two x and y's, two numbers x and y for which g has the same value. So it's easy to pick a number between 1 and e, call it y, and let's find a number on the right side between e and infinity which has the same value. So it's very easy to find one. You can see that for every x there's a y, and as y goes from 1 to e, x goes from infinity to e. So actually the meeting point here between the trivial solutions and the graph is the point ee. And we just basically prove that the graph does indeed tend to 1 as x tends to infinity, and therefore 2 and 4 are the only integer solutions to the problem. And that's cool, but because it wasn't late enough and I still had time before going to bed, I decided to ask myself, okay, what happens if I allow negative numbers to play in the game? And it's very easy to prove that negative 2 and negative 4, for example, do fulfill the rules of the game, because negative 2 to the power negative 4 is 1 16th, and negative 4 power negative 2 is also 1 over 16. And then, are there any other solutions? So, again, I threw the equation to the computer, let it graph, and this is what it showed to me. It did show not really a graph, but really a set of points, which was interesting. Well, of course, the identity still happens in negative numbers, like negative 2 power negative 2 is equal negative 2 times power negative 2, and even if you had something crazy like negative pi power negative pi, even though we couldn't really compute that, still something, still negative pi times power negative pi. So it makes sense that trivial solution does exist. However, because taking powers of negative numbers is not a well-defined operation, it makes sense to me that we don't get a graph, but just some isolated set of points. And what I mean is that, of course, negative 3 power 2, it's very easy, it's negative 3 times negative 3, which is 9. But then when you are doing negative 3 power 2.5, that becomes something more difficult, because that's 9 times the square root of negative 3, which is an imaginary number now. But hey, why not play with imaginary numbers? If this allows me to keep playing tonight, I will play and accept imaginary numbers and see what happens. So, The next thing to do was to kind of express the game again in imaginary numbers, complex numbers, sorry. But instead of doing it with the regular real and imaginary parts, I chose to describe the numbers with in their exponential form. And that will become handy in a little bit. But just to remind you, a complex number in exponential form is described by a modulo, which is pretty much how far the point or the number is from the origin of the complex plane, and an argument, which is what's the direction you should take from the origin of the plane in order to reach the point or number you are describing. The properties of taking powers of complex numbers are very easy to deal with when you are using exponential form, and that's really useful. So in our case, I'm going to split the problem in parts. So I'm going to first deal with the positive x, negative y part of the plane, and there we can express x as the modulo of x times the exponential of j0, and j to me means the square root of negative 1. So x equals modulo of x times exponential of j0, because x is a positive number, and then y becomes the modulo of y times the exponential of j pi, because y is a negative number, negative real number. Now, taking these and plugging them into the original equation of the game, we get that both modulos have to be equal to each other, and the arguments have to be equal to each other. So if we look at the modulos first, we get the power, absolute value of x power y equals absolute value of y power x, and that's the graph you get when you plot that part. And that's encouraging, because the graph seems to be passing through the yellow points that we thought or expected to be solutions to the problem. So this is a good sign. So let's have a look to the arguments now. If we equal arguments to each other, we get that 0 has to be equals to pi x. Now, there is something subtle going on here, which is that when dealing with arguments, if you add 2 pi to each either side of the equation is still valid, because arguments have this periodic behavior of 2 pi radians. So what we are really looking for is that 0 equals pi x plus minus a multiple of 2 pi. And I'm going to put an n there for that. If I isolate x now, I get that x equals 2n, which is an even number. So if we draw all the lines x equals an even number, we see them in the graph, and we see that they do intersect with the equation for the arguments, and exactly in the intersection points, that's where our original game is fulfilled, the rules of the game are fulfilled. And indeed, this is exactly where the yellow dots happen. So these were not artifacts of the plotting program, these are really solutions to the game. And just for the sake of example, I computed a few of these numbers. I'm gonna pick x equals 8, and in that case we get that negative 0.8101 blah 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 power 8 is exactly the same as 8 to the power of negative 0.8101 blah blah blah, which is very interesting. And now we have to look to the negative x, negative y part of the plane, because the top left quadrant, just by symmetry, behaves exactly the same as the bottom right quadrant. So on the negative x and negative y side of things, we can rewrite the whole game again in exponential form, and what we get is that we have to equal the arguments exactly the same as before. So the solutions must follow in this graph, and indeed the yellow dots do fall there. But now if you look at the arguments, we get that the pi times y equals x times pi plus a multiple of 2 pi. Again, if we isolate x and y and we remove the pi from the equation, we get that y minus x equals an even number, which is telling us that there is a whole set of lines with equation y equal x and parallel lines to those spaced out 2n units, or an even number of units, that must intersect the graph of the modulos, and in those intersections we should find the solutions. And indeed, the yellow dots we were getting originally do fall exactly in the intersection of these parallel lines with the graph of absolute values, and that's, we can find a negative 2 and negative 4 exactly there as expected. So conclusion is 2 and 4 are the only natural numbers that fulfill the game. Negative 2 and negative 4 can be added to those to get all the integers that follow the rules of the game. And then there are infinitely many real numbers which also satisfy the game in the positive side of things. And there's a smaller but still infinite number of x and y values that also satisfy the equation on the negative quadrants of the plane. And it's not to me to say that one infinite is bigger than another infinite, that's something for mathematicians, but for me it looks like in the positive side of things we have infinitely many solutions and you can keep zooming in the equation and find more solutions, while in the negative side of things you only get a disjoint set of points, although still infinite. Anyway, that was the game, and now it is really late, so it's time to go to bed.